about the power of living a blessed life. Tell your neighbor, there's power in living a blessed life. I'm living a blessed life.
Jesus begins the Sermon on the Mount by talking about 8 ways to be blessed by God. What's a blessing? How do you define a blessing? Would you know a blessing if it slapped you in the face? I mean, the Bible says that sometimes a problem is a blessing. And if you pray for God to bless somebody, how do you even know if it's happened or not, if you don't know what a blessing is? The word blessed in the Bible is the Greek word makarios. And makarios is the word for happy. To have a blessing is to have happiness in your life.
You don't know what it is to live a blessed life till you've lived a blessed life.
And when Jesus talks about you're blessed if you do this, he's saying you're gonna be happy if you do this. It's the exact same word.
You don't know how wonderful the blessed life is until you experience it. Some people think they're living a blessed life. They think their life is fabulous, but they don't really know how good it is until they've tasted the blessed life. And I wanna talk about that today because ultimately God's desire, according to Psalm 1, is that God wants us to have a blessed life. The word blessed means to be happy. It's not the happiness that the world offers. The world offers a happiness that fades away, comes and goes. The happiness that the world offers is conditional. It's based on what's going on in your life. But the scripture says here that God wants to bless us and give us a blessed life. Happy is the man who is having a blessed life, has happy. And then he begins to give us and walk us through this first psalm, these 6 verses, and that's what I wanna do. I wanna go and look at these 6 verses and see what insight it gives us, because I've discovered that a lot of people are longing for and hungering for the blessed life.
So I'm extremely interested in how to receive the blessings of God. As we study scripture, we find that the problem isn't with God, the problem is with us. God wants to bless your life. You just have to get blessable. And a lot of us don't live lives in ways that God can bless. God isn't gonna bless sin. God isn't gonna bless arrogance. God isn't gonna bless indifference. There are a lot of things God will not bless. One of the greatest sources of stress you're gonna have in your life is anxiety about money. In fact, studies show it's the number one cause of divorce, financial pressure. It's the number one anxiety-producing issue. Money. Am I gonna have enough to survive? Am I gonna have enough to make it? Financial worries. It keeps people awake at night. It causes people to do all kinds of stupid things because they start worrying about money.
Psalm 1, verse 1. He begins by giving us point one principle. It says, blessed is the man who walks not in the counsel of the ungodly, nor stands in the path of sinners, nor sits in the seat of the scornful, but his delight is in the law of the Lord, and in his law he meditates day and night. He shall be like a tree planted by the rivers of water. He brings forth its fruit in its season, whose leaf also shall not wither, and whatever he does shall prosper. The ungodly are not so, but are like the chaff which the wind drives away. Therefore, the ungodly shall not stand in the judgment, nor sinners in the congregation of the righteous. For the Lord knows the way of the righteous, but the way of the ungodly shall perish.
The Sermon on the Mount is in Matthew chapter 5, chapter 6, and chapter 7. Chapter 5 starts like this. When Jesus saw the crowds, he went up on the mountain, and after he sat down, his disciples came to him, and he began to teach them. And then he gives the first of these 8 conditions for being blessed by God. And he says this, blessed are the poor in spirit, for theirs is the kingdom of heaven. Now that doesn't tell me a whole lot because I don't understand most of the words in that verse. First, I don't know what poor in spirit means, and I don't know what the kingdom of heaven is. So we've got to unpack this for you to understand the benefit to your life. First, what is the kingdom of heaven? Is that different from the kingdom of God? We're gonna look at what is the kingdom of God and why it is so incredibly important to your life and why you definitely wanna be a part of it.
Psalm 1, he gives us the principle in verse 1 of the blessed life. Here it is right here, verse 1. Blessed is the man who walks not in the counsel of the ungodly, nor stands in the paths of sinners, nor sits in the seat of the scornful. That first verse lays out the principle. And here's what the principles are. He tells us, to be the blessed man, you have to, first of all, the principle says, watch where you walk. Here's what he says, the man will be blessed who has watched where he's walked, and he's not walking in the counsel of the ungodly. Y'all walk with me through this because this will change your life. This is life transforming. It changed my life. He says, blessed is the man who's made a choice, who's discerned and watched and observed, and he is not walking in the counsel of the ungodly. He is not walking. That word walk means a course of life, a way that you're living your life. He says, that man who is not listening to the advice or the counsel of the ungodly person, the sinner, the morally wrong, bad person. Here's the problem that a lot of people have. You are taking counsel from people who don't know what they're talking about. That's problematic when you are getting advice on your finances from somebody who done filed bankruptcy 2 or 3 times. It's problematic when you're getting counsel for your marriage from somebody who ain't never been married. It's problematic though if you're gonna give counsel from somebody for your marriage and they done married 3 or 4 times. If you're gonna get counsel, find somebody who can demonstrate, who has demonstrated that they know how to manage their money or they know how to make their marriage work. Whatever it is you need, find somebody who knows how to do it. Y'all are making mistakes. We are making mistakes by listening to people who do not know what the heck, and I feel like saying something else right there, they are talking about. Can I get an amen right there from anybody? And the writer here of Psalm 1 says, blessed is the man who's not listening to the counsel of ungodly people. Not listening to the advice, the suggestions, the direction of somebody who has not shown success or that they know how to do it themselves.
Now, what does it mean to be poor in spirit? Well, he's not talking about physical poverty. He doesn't say blessed are the poor. He says blessed are the poor in spirit. He's not talking about economic poverty. He's talking about spiritual poverty. He's talking about maintaining a certain kind of attitude. The New Living Translation says, God blesses those who realize their need for him. The God's Word Translation says, God blesses those who recognize they're spiritually helpless. Common English Version says, God blesses those who depend only on him. And New Century Version says, God blesses those who know they have great spiritual needs. To be poor in spirit, which is the first condition for God's blessing on your life, means I humbly depend on God because I know I'm inadequate to handle all the problems that face me in life. A good verse that helps clarify this is Psalm 146, verse 5. The Lord blesses everyone who trusts him and depends on him. This is the first condition for God's blessing on your life. You got to trust him. You've got to depend on him. And that's what it means to be poor in spirit.
Blessed is the man who is watching where he walks. But hold up, he doesn't say just that. He says right here, also, nor stands in the paths of sinners. He says, not only watch where you walk, but watch where you stand. I got one person standing up. Thank you. I appreciate that, baby. Appreciate it. God bless you. What does that mean? Well, y'all not going to like this point right here. Because the word stand means to be connected to or hooked to. He says, the man's going to be blessed who's not hooked.
Amen. Praise the Lord.
In the path of sinners. See, some of y'all have been so connected, hooked, bound to sinners that whatever they do, you don't have enough courage to say, I'm not doing.
You don't have enough courage.
This is why your life ain't blessed. You don't have enough courage to tell them, no, I'm not going to the club. But you got to have enough courage. You have enough to have enough fortitude, enough insight to recognize that nothing good ever came from you hanging out in the path of where the sinners go. You ain't going to get a word from the Lord at the club or at the lounge hanging out with sinners. You ain't going to get it there. You want life. You want joy. You want peace. You want everything that God has for you, but you keep staying connected and hooked to people who don't even know God. He says that you don't walk in the counsel of the ungodly, nor stands in the paths of sinners, nor sits in the seat of the scornful. That means you don't dwell, remain, settle with. Hold up. If you look up sit in the Hebrew, it means get married to scornful people. You don't sit in the seat of those who are scornful. And the word scornful means to make fun of, to mouth at. You see, I think a part of the problem is y'all are hanging out with people you're interested in, you are loving on, you are engaged to people who talk bad about God and talk bad about Jesus and talk bad about church. I'm trying to help you out. I want to give you some advice. I want to make a suggestion to you that you need to be careful about hanging out with people who are scornful about the things of God. And by the way, single people, single ladies, just because he go to church don't mean that he's a Christian. One day a week does not make a Christian. I want to know, what does he do the rest of the week? Is there evidence in his life or in her life. I need to say him or her. One day a week, they don't make her a Christian either. Look at your neighbor and say, I know that's right. Some of the women are just as whorish, if not more, than the men. Don't write me no letters. Don't send me no emails. Don't call me up. Is there any evidence in their life that there's some level of a relationship with God? The psalmist says that you don't sit, you don't connect to, you don't get married, you don't stay in love with, you don't become too hooked to somebody who sits in the seat of being scornful at the things of God. So he says, watch where you walk, watch where you stand, watch where you sit. That's the principle. Be careful of where you go. Be careful of who you hang out with. That's the principle. Matter of fact, I think I need to allow you just a few moments to begin to write the names of the people that you need to call when this service is over and say, it's over. I'm not hanging out with you anymore. But the reality of the fact is, the principle is, the man will be happy, the person, the woman will be happy, blessed by God, if they learn to watch who they hang out with. Here's what Amos says, two people can't walk together unless they agree. Here's what 2 Corinthians 6 says, come out from among them. That's what it says. You cannot move forward. Here's the bottom line. The people you hang out with are either influencing you or you are influencing them. And if they're not getting saved, then the chances are they are more so influencing you than you are influencing them. Yeah, I know this is a tough pill to swallow. It's a tough thing to talk about because we love people. Y'all, and people think that, hey, I love them and they my friend. We go way back. You got to make a decision. Do you want to keep hanging out with the people who go way back with you, or do you want to hang out with the King of Kings and the Lord of Lords? Do you want to hang out with the one who has the power and the ability to open up doors that no man can close? Do you want to hang out with the one who sees everything you do and everything you say and every place you go and everything you think and every word that comes out of your mouth? Because the problem is, some of the people that you hang out with, you talk like them, act like them, you become one of them when you're around them because you want to be accepted by them. Go on and preach, Pastor. And I'm just trying to tell you, you gotta want Jesus more than you want them.
If I want God's blessing on my relationship to my girlfriend, my boyfriend, my husband, my wife, or anybody else, then I've got to be dependent upon God. If I want God's blessing on my work, in my career, in my studies, if I want God's blessing in my finances, in my health, I have to humbly depend on God instead of myself. I want to give you five practical ways to do this from the Word of God. And if you practice these, you will become a woman or a man who is poor in spirit, which means you depend on God rather than yourself. You understand your need for God in your life. And then that's the kind of woman, that's the kind of man that God says, I like to bless. Five ways to express my dependence on God. Number one, to be blessed by God, first, I depend on God's wisdom, not mine. In other words, I listen to what God says, I follow what God says to do, and I do what he says to do. Proverbs chapter 14, verse 12 says this, there is a way that seems right to a man, but in the end, it leads to death. It's a dead end. He said, our ideas often lead to dead ends. It leads to death. That's what this verse is all about. And every one of us could give a testimony on this, where you've had this feeling, this hunch that this is the perfect job, and it ends up being a dead end. This is the perfect person that I should marry, and I know this is the person. And we all know people who've made that decision, and it flopped miserably. It happens in friendships. It can happen in investments. I know this is where I should put my money. This is a sure winner. This is a big deal. I know if I invest in this, it's going to be great. And then it just totally flops. Think of painful examples where you wish that you would listen to God instead of your gut, because God is filled with truth and your gut is filled with pizza. The Bible says there's a way that seems right, but it ends in a dead end. So the first way to get God's blessing in your life is I depend on God's wisdom, not mine.
He lays down the principle. Watch where you walk, watch where you stand, watch where you sit. But then he goes further. That's the principle. He gives us the program. Point two, somebody says program. It's a very simple program. It's in verse two. It's point two and it's in verse two. Here's the program. Here's how you carry it out. But his delight, verse two, is in the law of the Lord. And in his law, he meditates day and night. Oh, that's powerful right there. Here's the program. Here's what he wants us to do. You got to learn to delight in the law of the Lord. His desire. He takes pleasure. That's what delight means. You take pleasure in the law of God. You take pleasure in his precepts and his concepts, his statutes. You get excited. You love. You delight yourself in it. You find joy in it. His delight is in the law of the Lord. Psalm says, delight yourself in the Lord and he'll give you the desires of your heart. Psalm 34. God wants us to get delight and get joy and get excitement out of his word. Now notice what he says. His delight is in the law of the Lord, the commands of God, the word of God. And he doesn't stop there, but he says, and in his law, he meditates day and night. He says, here's a person who's happy. Here's the person who's blessed because they have learned how to get delight in the Lord's word and they meditate. That person meditates on it day and night. Now listen here. This is worth the price of admission right here. He uses the word meditate. You all think God should be happy because you read it. There's a difference between reading and meditating. Thank all 17 of y'all. Some of y'all feel good because you get up in the morning and you read that chapter and you think everything's fine. The Bible doesn't say, blessed is the man who reads the word. Here's the thing that distinguishes the men from the boys, from people who are going to get blessed versus those who don't, those who'll be happy versus those who don't. He says he meditates on the law. That word meditate means to chew it over. It means to murmur, to ponder. It means to rethink it over again and again. It means you're murmuring it to yourself. And you know, it's nothing wrong with you talking to yourself. Some people talk to yourself. There's nothing wrong with talking to yourself. The only thing that's wrong with talking to yourself is when you ain't talking the right thing to yourself. Come on, talk to me for a second. Some people talk to themselves, but they don't say the right thing while they're talking to themselves.
If you want to have fewer dead ends in your life, you want to have fewer defeats, fewer failures in your life, next verse is for you. Proverbs 3, 5 to 7. Trust the Lord with all your heart. Not what I think, but I trust in the Lord with all my heart and lean not on my own understanding. Don't depend on your hunches and your feelings. Those are often lead you astray. Seek his will, God's will, in all you do. And he, God promises, he will direct your paths. How do I get God's wisdom? You pray and you read. You talk to God and you read the Bible. You let him talk to you. The Bible says in James chapter 1, verse 5, if any of you lacks wisdom, you should pray and ask God, who gives it generously and graciously to all. Now, notice he gives it to everybody. All you got to do is just ask for it. And it's not like you're waiting on him. He's waiting on you.
And here's what the text says. It says you meditate on it. It says day and night. I looked up the word day. I wanted to find out what it meant. It's a Hebrew word, and it means daily, every day. It means I'm pondering it, and I'm meditating on God's truth every day. This is the thing that distinguishes people who have powerful, blessed lives from those who don't. This is the thing that makes a difference, is the ability to know that this word right here has life, and you meditate on it, and you chew on it, and you eat it, and ponder it, has a way of life. And the text says, not only does he meditate on it day, it also says he does it at night. I looked up the word night, and it didn't mean at night. It means in the midst of adversity. That word night means you're meditating on the word when things are going well and when things are not going well. It means you are chewing on it and putting hope in it and having confidence in it and holding fast to it even when things are not going the way you want them to go. God says, I'm gonna make that person happy. God's blessing exceeds material blessings. Here's what I'm trying to tell you. It's not just talking about material blessings. It's not just about money. Because what I discovered is that God can bless you and give you things that money can't buy. That's what I want. I want the kind of blessings that God can put in my life that money cannot buy. So he gives us the program. That's the program. Meditate, delight in the word, the law of the Lord, and in that law, meditate, chew on it, drink it, think about it, ponder it, speak it to yourself. Day and night, when things are well and when they're not well, when the sun is shining and when the sun is not shining, meditate on it at all times. That is the program.
How do you know when you are living on God's wisdom rather than on your wisdom? If you're not talking to God throughout your whole day, God, I'm getting ready to go into this meeting. I'm getting ready to go into this class. I'm getting ready to go meet with some friends. What do I do? What do I say? And you're not talking to God like that all day. And if you're not reading God's word on a daily basis, you are depending on your own wisdom. And it's why you have so many problems and why so many things fall through and why you end up with so much pain in your life. Would you write this down? God's wisdom and God's will are in God's word. God's wisdom and will is in God's word. And if you're not in the word, you don't know God's will. And if you're not in the word, you don't have God's wisdom. And if you don't have God's wisdom, you can't be blessed.
You got the principle, you got the program. Here's number three, here's the promise. Somebody say there's a promise. Now the promise is in verse 3. You shall be like a tree planted by the rivers of water that brings forth its fruit in its season. Its leaf also shall not wither, and whatever he does shall prosper. Not a bush, not a limb, or a branch. He'll be like a tree. And look at what the tree is. The tree is planted. They need to talk about that because we got some unplanted people walking around here. Unstable. When you're not planted, you're unstable. You're all over the place. Unstable. God will plant you. God will put you in a place of stability. I don't know about y'all. I have been through enough in my life. I could have lost my mind. I should have had a nervous breakdown. There's a whole bunch of people I should have cussed out. But I'm planted.
Hallelujah.
I'm stable. And here's what I like about being planted. It's not just being planted. It's where he plants. She said, I'm going to always plant you in a place where there's always water nearby. He said, he shall plant you by the rivers of water. And see, here's the thing about rivers of water. I always got something to nurture and feed myself on. While everybody else is dry, I always got some water nearby to draw from. I always got something to feed on. That's what God promises to do. Do y'all hear what I'm saying to you today? He promises to do that. He will give us rivers, put us by rivers of water. We'll be like a tree planted by rivers of water. Hold up. That brings forth its fruit in its season.
Let me give you another one. Number two, Psalm 84, verse 5. God says, you bless all who depend on you for their strength. You want God's blessing in your life? You need to depend on God for your strength. Your strength is finite. God's strength is infinite. Now, what do you do when your strength evaporates? I got too many things to do and not enough energy to do it. Here's a good promise, Isaiah 40, 31. Those who trust in the Lord for help will find their strength renewed. They will rise on wings like eagles. They will run and not get weary. They will walk and not grow weak. When you cannot see your way forward, you need God's strength to get you through. I've seen people go through a divorce and they never recover. I've seen people go through a breakup and they never recover. I've seen them go through a bankruptcy or getting fired or getting laid off or getting arrested. I've seen people go through all kinds of different things, you know, abuse. And they never recover. Why? Because they're depending on their own strength. You're not going to get through it.
He says, I'm going to bring forth its fruit in its season. I love that from God. In other words, he says, when your season is due, because you are a blessed person, you will have fruit when it's your season. Because some of y'all, it's been a long time since you've had a season. Some of you have come to your season and there hasn't been any fruit. It's been dry.
Because you're not blessed.
But when you're blessed, every time you come to your season, you're going to be blessed. There's a season for sowing and then there's a season for harvest. There's a season to sow and a season to reap. There's a season to plant and a season to gather. The problem is we have people who come to the gathering season, the harvest season, and there's nothing there. That's because they didn't make the right choices during the sowing season. Here's the problem. We live in a culture and a generation that plants on Monday and expect a harvest by Friday. It don't happen like that. The Bible says, cast your bread upon the waters, and after many days, it shall return. You plant a seed, you don't stand there and watch it to see if it's gonna come up in the next few hours. We live in a culture that wants the harvest without the planting. They want the blessing, but they don't want the responsibility. Y'all don't hear what I'm saying today. They want the paycheck, but they don't want to come to work. They want a successful marriage, but they don't want to work on the marriage to make it work. It's the husband that wants some, but he don't want to treat his wife in a way beforehand. So when it comes time for something to happen, she feels like it, but he want to treat her bad and then come home at night and y'all ain't hear what I'm saying to you.
I put down here a couple verses that I would encourage you to memorize. One of them is for when you're young, and another one is for when you're old. But the first one, everybody can memorize this. It's only one sentence. Psalm 71:16. I walk in the strength of the Lord. I walk in the strength of the Lord. That's an affirmation. Psalm 71:16. I walk in the strength of the Lord. You make it the most important affirmation in your life. That is the kind of woman God blesses. That is the kind of man God blesses. God, I need you to give me the energy. I need to plug into the power. When you get older, you're gonna face the pains and problems of aging. And that gets pretty frightening. Just talk to somebody who's getting up in age and ask them that. And here's a good verse for then. Psalm 73:26 says this, my health may fail and my spirit may grow weak, but God remains the strength of my heart. He is mine forever. That's a great verse to remember. Everything may else fall apart in my life, but God is the strength of my heart. He is mine forever. Sometimes in your life, you're gonna be so weak, you can't even pray. You see, weakness can actually be a good thing in your life if it causes you to depend on God. This is from St. Paul. Paul says this, 2 Corinthians 12. Three times I begged God to take away my weakness. And each time God said, my grace is all you need. My power works best in your weakness. The third thing is I depend on God's timing, not mine. I depend on God's timing, not mine. A lot of times we think, while I'm waiting, nothing's happening. God is often working behind the scenes in ways you can't even see to get you ready for the answer to your prayer. While you're waiting, God's working.
And I love this. The scripture says, if you do the right planting,
you plant
and the right sowing,
water it,
you will always be productive. And he also says, your leaf also shall not wither. That means God will keep you fresh and alive at all times. Hold up, he didn't stop right there. Here's also another promise. I'm almost finished. And whatever he does shall prosper. Whatever he does shall prosper. Somebody say prosperity. Are y'all noticing my P's under the promise? I got the planting, the production, the prosperity. And here's what the word prosperity means. Prosperity doesn't mean money. Let me be clear. When I say prosperity, I'm not talking about money. The word prosperity here in the Hebrew means to be pushed forward. I'm telling you today that we serve a God who has the capacity and the ability and the desire to push you forward. I am living my life right now being put in situations that I don't deserve to be there. I'm not qualified. I don't earn it. I haven't deserved it. But because of the blessings of God, he has pushed me forward. I don't know who I'm talking to today, but God is about to push you forward. Put you in a job you didn't earn. Put you in a place you're not qualified for. Open up doors and put you in meetings and take it before people and do miracles for you because he has pushed you forward.
Whatever he touches.
Y'all not getting it. Y'all need to get it. Push forward.
God will push you forward.
Now let me just give you a little lesson. God always gives his best to those who wait.
Whatever he put his hands to.
And if you get in a hurry, you're going to settle for second best in your life. And before God brings the best man into your life, the best woman into your life, the best opportunity into your life, Satan's going to give you all kinds of detours. And you settle for less than God's best in your life. If you will wait for God's best, God always gives his best to those who leave the choice to him. But if you get frantic and you get nervous and you get in a hurry and you start trying to answer your own prayer, you will have a fatal flaw and a terrible mistake in your life. If you want God's blessing, you gotta learn this truth very deeply. Spiritual poverty means I don't do it myself. I depend on God's wisdom, I depend on God's strength, and I depend on God's timing. And he'll answer it when he knows I'm ready for the answer. Number four, to be blessed by God, I depend on God's wisdom, God's strength, God's timing, and I also depend on God's defense. I'll explain this. There's always gonna be people in your life who misunderstand you. Jesus was perfect, and a lot of people didn't like him. So even if you were perfect, even if you were Jesus, you're still going to be misunderstood by them because we live in a broken world. Listen to me very closely. Pioneers get the arrows in the back. If you're going to call the shots, you're going to take the shots. So to be a leader in a business means you're going to be criticized. To be a leader in a church means you're going to be criticized. Community, anywhere else. I want you to be fearless. What God wants is a generation of fearless men and fearless women. Now let me show you a couple of verses. Psalm chapter 2, verse 12. God blesses and God protects everyone who runs to him. The next verse, Psalm 62, gives us five metaphors. David says this, I depend on God alone. I put my hope in him. He alone protects. He alone saves. He is my defender. I shall not be defeated. My salvation and honor depend on God. What's your honor? It's your reputation. My salvation and my reputation depend on God. He is my strong protector and he is my shield. Now notice the five metaphors. God says he's my protector, he's my savior, he's my defender, he's my victor, and he's my shelter. He's saying, let me handle it. When you do that, you are being poor in spirit. You're saying, God, I'm not depending on myself. I'm depending on you. So let me just give you one more way to depend on God. And that is this. Number five, I depend on God's wealth, not mine. Here's what the Bible says about God's wealth, not yours. Philippians 4:19. And my God will supply all my needs. My God will supply all my needs from his abundant wealth. Circle that. It's God's wealth, not your wealth, that makes you secure. From his abundant wealth because of what Christ Jesus has done for me. My job is a channel, but God is my source. If you think that your job is what keeps you financially secure, you're going to be insecure your entire life. If you understand this, you'll have so much less stress in your life. My job is a channel, but God is the source of my supply.
I wish I could stop there, but there's three more verses. And those three more verses talk about punishment. Somebody say punishment. The ungodly are not so, verse 4, but are like the chaff which the wind drives away. When the farmer gathers his wheat, he gathers the whole grain of wheat and put all of the wheat together in a sifter. He takes the sifter and shakes it because the agitating of the sifter separates the good part of the grain from the bad part of the grain. And then he tosses everything in the air and the wind blows the bad part of the grain away. The ungodly are like the chaff which the wind drives away. Some of you have been put in relationships with people who are not good for you. So God puts you into a shifter. You and your friends that you've been walking with, standing with, sitting with, that's giving you bad counsel and bad advice and bad suggestions, God puts you in a situation that the relationships gets shaken. Then he tosses it in the air and then he blows the bad people away out of your life. And you crying and complaining because the people are not your friends no more. Stop crying and complaining. The wind has blown them away. There goes that joker you don't need. There goes that sister you don't need. Stop trying to hold on to people that God is trying to blow out of your life. Don't call them back. Don't tweet them. Don't text them. Don't email them. Don't face page, Facebook, whatever, face. What is it? I can never get it right. Don't Facebook them. What else did they do? Don't Instagram them. Don't Snapchat them. Skype. Don't Skype them. Are y'all listening to what I'm saying to you? There's some people you've been walking with, standing with, sitting with, but God wants to blow them out of your life. When the shaking comes and it gets tossed in the air, let God blow them away. God blowing them away and you going down the road picking them up, bringing them back into your life. Now it's time for him to go. God's trying to bless you. Somebody high five your neighbor and say he's trying to bless you. And when he does it in your life, he will bless you beyond your wildest dream. Somebody look at your neighbor and say, you're about to be pushed forward.
I'm going to pray a prayer and you can follow me in it. Let's bow our head. Dear God, Thank you for sending Jesus to teach us how to live and to die for my sins. I want your blessing on my life. So today, I want to take this first step of learning to depend on you more. I want to depend on your wisdom this week. Your wisdom, not mine, so you can replace my confusion with your confidence. I want to depend on your strength, not mine, so your power can show up in my weakness. I want to depend on your timing. Help me to be patient, quietly trust. I know that at the right time, you can change things instantly. And Lord, I want to quietly trust you for my defense. Finally, Lord, I want to look to you as a source to meet all my needs. Help me this week to walk in the strength of the Lord. And I pray this in Jesus' name. Amen.
I like living this kind of life. I like living this kind of life. I'm living a blessed life. I like living this kind of life.
My God shall supply all your needs according to his riches and glory in Christ Jesus.